Good morning, everyone. My name is Keon Abner. I'm a commissioned pastor in Cleveland, Ohio, pastoring Bridge City Church as a part of a church plant from Bay Presbyterian Church in the Presbytery of Alleghenies. I also represent, as you know, Bob Stauffer talked about, why do we need another split pea? I serve currently as the moderator of a covenant order of Evangelical Presbyterians, ECO. And I know we've got stereotypes about each other, but I'm glad to be here and glad to be a part of this family. Amen? Amen? We're planting Bridge City Church, which is a intentionally multi-ethnic church that was designed out of a heart to reach the city from an inner city black church and a suburban white church. And those two churches came together and sent me to plant with a team of folks in the heart of our city, in the most diverse zip code of our city. And so today, as we talk through this, we'll share a little bit more about what that ministry has entailed and what it has looked like so far.
So my name is Marc. In 2010, got to be a part of planting a church called Soma in the beautiful, while economically under-resourced community of Beaver Falls, Pennsylvania. Post-industrial steel town. And Soma is a neighborhood church committed to reconciliation and Christian community development. And so I'm no longer the pastor of that church. Someone else took over that role for me. I'm now a parish associate there, still living in that neighborhood. And I serve as a parish associate there. Also, I'm a staff resource in our presbytery, the Presbytery of the Alleghenies. And for all of those neighborhood-focused outreach efforts, outward-facing efforts in the EPC, and I'm talking here about church health and church planting and Revelation 7-9, all committed to that local neighborhood, that parish, that neighboring community. I work with our 74 churches in our presbytery to try to resource them to facilitate that outward movement. We heard some fantastic stories of people being equipped to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we need to equip our individuals to do that. We're convicted, though, that the activity of evangelism, if it's just individuals running around as they get inspired, even trained to do so, without the culture of evangelism from their community of faith, reinforcing that at the cultural level, we're not gonna be really bearing a kingdom witness in the way that we are called to as the EPC, but for crying out loud, just as the body of Jesus Christ. What Pastor Aaron shared earlier today, that we so atomize, condense down, individualize our faith, and the same can be true of our evangelism. It is individual, but it's fundamentally corporate. And so what's it look like for churches, communities of faith, to understand that good news priority? And specifically what we're talking about here today in our time, this idea of loving the neighborhood, churches being out in the community in order to bear witness. And there's a certain kind of posture and a certain kind of practice to this idea, to actually get to know your neighborhood in a way that you can actually bear that faithful witness. But there's a starting place I want to go to. I want to look at the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 to 37. We're told there, this is kind of that summary of the ministry of Jesus Christ, that Jesus went through all the towns and the villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest field." Now, I didn't grow up in a Presbyterian church setting. I grew up in a church that was super into evangelism. I was one of those kids doing the street evangelism, knocking on doors, talking to everybody. Like, as a young person, really zealous for that. I'm grateful for the zeal that created in me. I also really struggled, though, with some serious anxiety because, like, at 10 years old, I'm believing that if my friends end up apart from God forever, that was my fault because I didn't do a good enough job. And so one of the gifts of the Reformed theological tradition for me is in this passage. I had never thought of this part of it until a few months ago, listening to a pastor preach this passage and his emphasis, because when I grew up, what was the emphasis? The workers are few. because it's a call to what? Go be one of those workers. But here was his emphasis: the harvest is plentiful. When you think of farming or gardening, cultivating, what's the hard work to do? What's the hard work? The hard work is the establishing the land, isn't it? It's the tilling of the soil. It's the cultivating the field. It's the tending to the weather. It's the, and then what's the fruit of the hard work? It's the harvest. What are we told here? Not the harvest will be plentiful when you go out and make it happen. The harvest already is plentiful. It is the sovereignty of God. And what we're called to as the EPC, members of the body of Christ, to bear kingdom witness, the hard work, friends, has been done. People are called to life in Christ. We get to bear witness, and we get to be people who harvest, who gather in those whom God has already called. Does this make sense? And so what a gift to be both active, but then also trusting in God's sovereignty. So in the larger context of the work of church health in the EPC, we have this thing called, this priority called refocus. And it really is about reorienting. And this is kind of like fundamental to what we do in the EPC. And we have this five phases of church vitality. So if you've been a church that is going through a church refocus process or have a transitional pastor, this is what we're looking to see the church do, to move toward health, that outward facing health. There's these different phases, aligning perception, vision, strategy, structure, and people. What we're talking about here today is we're talking about kind of what fits really nicely in that phase two, that aligning of vision. Who is it that God is sending us to? If we're gonna be a body of Christ on mission for God in this neighborhood, as we're discerning, what is that supposed to look like? To whom are we being called, and what shape will that take? This neighborhood exegesis is a practice that's meant to help us understand how to do that most faithfully. So in the EPC, we talk about being Reformed, Presbyterian, Evangelical, and missional. You've heard those before, right? So when we talk about missional, one of the ways we can talk about that is developing this evangelistic culture. The identity of the church is about sharing the good news of Jesus Christ and inviting people into life with him. One of the folks who's very formative for a lot of us who are really taken to that missional understanding of church, Leslie Newbegin, missionary in India in the 20th century. In one of his books, The Gospel in a Pluralist Society, he talks about this identity of the church. And he talks about the local church being a community that doesn't live for itself, but is deeply involved in the concerns of its neighborhood. It's the church for the specific place where it lives, not the church for those who wish to be members of it. Or rather, it will be for them insofar as they are willing to be for the wider community. And then honing in on this, a Christian congregation is God's embassy in a specific place, where its neighborhood looks to find the good news of God overflowing. That embassy of the kingdom of God. Notice it doesn't say the building, it's the congregation, it's the people. So people who have been given good news and then get to bear witness to that good news, we're being called to live more faithfully into that in our neighborhood. So when I say neighborhood exegesis, I know folks have used that. That's not like a Bible term you're gonna see. And so defining what we mean when we say that, a practice of recognizing the evidence of God's redemptive presence already at work in your church's neighboring community. It's a practice that inspires kingdom celebration, participation, demonstration, and proclamation. So what Pastor Keon and I are trying to do in a few minutes here today is just share some ideas and some stories. This idea of exegeting the neighborhood. Where is God already at work in this place? And then we're going to join him in the work of his kingdom, that redemptive work. And then we're gonna point people back to where that good news comes from in the first place and invite them into life with Jesus Christ. And so there's a posture to this work. There's a posture that's really important, and it might be for some of us maybe that first obstacle in the culture of our churches, especially if we've been around for a while as churches, we've developed some of that institutional identity, and it's hard to kind of really get outward facing, but there's a process that can help us, and there's some steps along the way. One of those, when we think about neighborhood exegesis, the posture of neighborhood exegesis. How does our congregation relate to the neighboring community, those folks who live in the place where God has placed our church on purpose and with a purpose? And so I'm going to give kind of three different paradigms for how a church can understand itself in relationship to the community. And it's probably not going to surprise you which one we would prefer. Any list of three for those of you who teach, you know what the answer is already, but I'll put them all up there for you anyhow. First, a fortress, the fortress relationship, the posture toward the neighboring community. You can probably imagine what this looks like and feels like. You are in the community. I mean, your building has a physical address in this specific place, and that's kind of it. That's kind of the relationship that you have with the neighborhood. Maybe in your past, you were deeply committed, invested in relationship, but things have changed, the neighborhood changed, your church changed. That doesn't exist anymore. A fortress posture, that primary verb is that you're gonna hide. You're gonna hide, you're gonna be pulled away, you're gonna be disconnected, but there's even that maybe a posture of fear and suspicion. Church architecture of a certain period in American history with beautiful vaulted kind of wooden ceilings, kind of like an upside down arc. And you can even imagine how that kind of, there's an ecclesiology that's shaped there. We're gonna get in this place and we're gonna ride this thing out. And one day when Jesus comes back, we'll emerge again. We're gonna hide out. It's a big, scary world out there. This is the posture, the mentality of the fortress. It's a cold, dark place out there. We better hide away here. Or not just flight, but even right now, I think we can see a kind of a reemerging sense of fight, where the fortress becomes the place not only to hide away from the community, but even to kind of gear up with the weapons of culture war and fight that fight, the fortress mentality. The question here is, what if they? What if they? There's a threat out there. Show of hands, who thinks this is what we should aspire to? I didn't think so, but we got folks in our churches who do, don't they? And we gotta disciple them with a better alternative, with a better, more faithful identity as God's people. Here's the next one, and this one's challenging because this one probably feels good and probably feels familiar to a lot of us. I would call this the savior posture. The savior posture, right? This relationship is you're here, you're in the community, and you're for the community, right? So you care, you do care about what goes on out there, but the primary verb here is to fix. Right, so the question here is how do we, and it tends to really revolve around needs. What are the needs in this place? What are the problems? Where is the brokenness? Because God loves us, he loves them. We're gonna go meet needs, and as we go meet people's needs, then we're gonna be able to share the gospel or be good news in this neighborhood. And I wanna speak to, like, I love the heart that wants to help people. That's a beautiful thing. You can't teach a want to, but I think we need to equip each other in the how to. Because one of the limitations of that savior posture is that it's really hard to then, when you start there, to then develop like actual mutual relationship. How many of you have a really deep, intimate relationship with your primary care physician? Because that's not their role. Their job in your life is kind of to do fixing. Right? And so intimacy is a hard thing. It's kind of like if the first time I meet you, I say, what's your name? My name's Marc. What's wrong with you? Maybe I can fix it. How likely are we then to lean into a deep mutual relationship, right? So you hear in church health language, we're talking about serving to build relationships, to share the gospel. Service is not a bad thing, but let's imagine service like the hallway. The hallway is not the destination. Don't stop there. The destination is the banquet room. It's the family, and this is that movement into that partner relationship. The partner says, we're with this community. We're here, and we're for, but we're fundamentally with. And the primary verb here is to listen. We're paying attention. That goes back to that neighborhood exegesis. Where is God already doing his good work here in this place? The provenience of God, something we believe in the sovereignty, the provenient presence of God, he's already at work before we can recognize it. Is that true in your own life? Was God at work in you before you said yes to him? Amen. Amen. Is God at work in your neighboring community, even if the neighbors don't yet know it? Yep. Yes. The church is called to bear witness, to be aware to announce, to demonstrate, and to invite into that new life. So where is God already at work? An incredibly important posture. There's a passage here, Mark chapter 6. Mark chapter 6, where Jesus is feeding the thousands. And I'm sure you're familiar with that story in Mark's version. It's a really powerful thing that the disciples first, when they bring a problem to Jesus, and they say, folks got no food and we need to eat, their first suggestion is, let's send them away. Not here, can't happen here, right? And then Jesus gives them one of his Jesus responses, right? And he says, will you feed them? And then the disciples say what? It would take so much money to do that. What's their next solution, money? Is that ever our idea, that the solution is money? Yeah, but then Jesus says, how many loaves do you have? Go and see. And they go out amongst the crowd to gather in what the crowd possesses. Was it enough? In the human imagination, no. When it's in the hands of Jesus, it becomes more than enough to meet the need to then give the invitation to talk about the deeper need. And so the neighborhood exegesis says, we don't already know. That would be neighborhood eisegesis. If we say, we already know what this place needs. No, we need to discover where God's already at work. The posture of humility to listen. And there's a practice that we can move into that. So Pastor Keon, share with us some of the praxis of exegesis.
So when we think about how a church goes about engaging in being, what we say at Bridge City is that we want to practice faithful presence in our neighborhood. Let me just say that these clocks are really large. And to a black preacher, that's offensive. So many clocks. No, I'm joking. So, sorry, I just needed to break the ice, I'm sorry. When we think about the work of engaging in a neighborhood, specifically one by which we are not familiar with, as Marc said, a posture of humility is one that allows God to use you to do more than you could ever imagine. But if you approach it with a mindset that we've got this under control and that we know what they need, you miss out on God's opportunity to both disciple you and to help you evangelize. When we approach neighborhood exegesis from the posture of I have much to learn, God can do so much differently than if we approach it with I have so much to offer. I was serving as an elementary school administrator when God called me to serve with Bay Prez as they wanted to engage in a city opportunity to plant a church in the inner city. Cleveland is historically segregated, and so people pretty much live with people who are like them in the city. And the most diverse zip code of Cleveland is our neighborhood, Clark Fulton, where Bay Prez owned a campus where they were seeking to do greater ministry. New Life at Calvary was desiring to plant, which is my home church, in the inner city. And I've grown up in the inner city my entire life. And one of the things, speaking to Mark's last point about God has already been at work, one of the things that we found out after being in partnership for so long was the summer camp that I attended as a young man, 8, 9, 10, 11 years old, was actually paid for by Bay Prez, who sought to do inner city ministry long before they ever thought that their church planter would be that young man who got to know Jesus and who got to be discipled at that summer camp. Now, the roots of that, we decided to plant. Now, it's not missed on me in 2019 that how are we gonna bring black folks and white folks together to plant in a largely populated Hispanic neighborhood? Sounds like a start of a bad joke, doesn't it? My friend still to this day calls my church a social experiment. So what we did was, and through the blessing of the pandemic, we brought these communities together and we chose a core team of folks and we just practiced faithful presence in the neighborhood. No worship services, no Bible studies. We just found opportunities to engage. So I want to offer for us a threefold way to do this practically in our neighborhood. Number one, we want to start with listening, the posture of listening. I always reflect on Exodus where God says, I have heard the cries of my people and am concerned about their suffering. The posture that God takes to saving Israel and through that the rest of the world is through listening. Then think to Eugene Peterson's words as he paraphrases John chapter 1, verse 1, when he says, God moved into the neighborhood. These postures can color how we operate in a neighborhood. So in order to listen, what we did was we did prayer walks. And prayer walks, at its glance, it seems very awkward at first. And so what we did was we divided up into teams so there wasn't a big mob of people walking through the neighborhood praying for people. That would be weird, especially in our neighborhood. So we broke up into groups, and so it was me and five other folks, and those five other folks didn't look much like me. And so we're walking, and we're praying, and we're meeting people, and a man looks at us, and he goes over, he says, you all look religious. And I'm like, here we go. And I'm like, what do you mean? He says, well, are you all Christians? I'm like, yeah, we're Christians. He's like, what kind of Christians? And I'm like, I am not about to explain Presbyterianism right now in the middle of the street. I said, well, we're Christians who believe the Bible and we love Jesus. He's like, well, can you all pray for me? And I'm like, all right. So I look at my team and Patty says, I'll pray for you. You got any specific prayer requests? He says, pray for me to find a woman. And as the pastor, I am amazed to see how this is going to shake out. So she says, all right. So we circle up and we start praying. And I'm like, with my eyes open, trying to just see how everybody's feeling. So she's praying and she does pray that the Lord might lead him to some form of companionship. That was the language in her prayer. But I looked at him while she was praying and he was waiting to hear specific language about his prayer request. So before she said amen, he said, did you pray for a woman? And she says, yes, I prayed for a woman. That was the last time we saw, his name is Jeff. That was the last time we saw Jeff. And as far as we were concerned as a team, that would have been the last time we would have ever seen Jeff. The church had not started. We had not opened the doors yet. We were just practicing faithful presence. A year later, we're having service, and we announced that we're having a baptism class. For those who have come to faith in Christ who want to take that next step, we're having a baptism class. I go and do the pastor thing and greet folks at the door, and afterward, I go down to the classroom to have this baptism class. And there in that room, did I do that? Is a man who was with our original prayer group, and Jeff. Jeff doesn't know who Phil is, and Phil didn't know who Jeff was because they didn't remember. But as I'm sitting in the class and I'm teaching, and I didn't know either. The man was emotional. He had come to the service and all that. And so Philip told me, yeah, he's emotional, but he wanted to come to the baptism class. So I'm starting to teach the baptism class. And as I'm teaching the class, Jeff says, you all got some nice women in this church. And I said, I know who you are. I remember you. So long story short, we go through the baptism class. Jeff makes a profession of faith. Jeff gets baptized. Jeff shows up on the morning of the baptism. We got these baptism t-shirts. He puts on his t-shirt and he says, I get a new family today. We never would have known that practicing faithful presence would have been the work of evangelism and discipleship before the first service. Because I went to church planter trainings that taught me if I didn't start the service as soon as I could, we were never going to get a return on our investment. Well, they didn't use that language. That was my way of transcribing what they said. But they were like, you've got to do this. You've got to build it large. You've got to go to this community where people make this type of money, and this is the only way. But what I have learned is that that is not necessarily God's design for planting churches. That's God's design for starting successful businesses. So at a church, we got to do things differently. So we listen, and we're still listening to this day. We're still learning to this day. We're still finding out. Another posture of listening is neighborhood mapping, where you are actually taking the time to list out the unique resources, not just resources as in agencies or institutions, but people. And you're listing them out. You're learning to find out, what are they doing? Who are they? What do they care about? One practice is even just taking a coffee to a neighbor and saying, can I sit on your porch and just hear your story? Not necessarily sharing the gospel. Of course, if the opportunity shows itself, I'll pull out my phone and pull out the circles and do what I just learned 5 minutes ago. But the opportunity was for me to understand, how am I going to pastor? How am I going to preach? How am I going to engage in this neighborhood? So through that, we built relationships. The second part is engaging. Most churches, most inner city folks, criticism of the church is not that they don't engage correctly, it's that they don't engage at all. But they're always inviting us to their events. And they're always doing things and telling us we need to come. But they're not engaging with what God is doing here. Showing up in moments of crisis, I keep what's called a ghost calendar on my pastoral calendar. It's not a calendar of appointments. It's a calendar of opportunities to engage in our neighborhood. So when an opportunity presents itself, I know where to go. When is the councilwoman having her meetings? What does she need? When are other churches doing these? I found out when we were getting ready to do a trunk or treat, because that's what churches do in 2020 after post-2020. We do trunk or treats. And so I'm like, we need to do a trunk or treat too, because we're a church. Then I found out there were four churches within a 1 minute distance of our church doing trunk or treats on the same weekend. So I called those leaders and said, you need volunteers, because we wanted to engage. You see, after listening, you have to get on the ground and start being present so that people know you, that they're comfortable with you, that they understand that you are a person of peace. They may not come to know Jesus today, maybe not even in your lifetime, but they might say, I could always talk to that person. Well, that person was always kind to me. You've got to engage. One thing that startled our team was, next door to our church, a sign went up saying, Frank D's. And it was giving vibes like it was a strip club. And I'm like, oh man, that's gonna be interesting. And so we were all nervous, and I had heard reports. I would come to work the next come to work and see that there were bottles, alcohol bottles on the ground, and so on and so forth. Then one day we were having an evening service, and it was outdoors, and I happened to see a man walking out of Frank D's, and I went over and said, "Hey, what's your name?" He says, "I'm Frank D." And I said, "I've been waiting to meet you," and we started talking. Now here's the deal. Frank D does not go to our church, but Frank D tells everybody that we are his church. And I'm concerned about it a little bit, but not too much. Not too much, not too much. It's okay, we're a church for all people, praise the Lord. But the opportunity to engage with Frank D, I've noticed less alcohol bottles. I've noticed that the sign that said all trespassers will be shot, including the police, is now covered with a mural. Progress, progress, because we engage. But the last one, and this is hard, is that you've got to bear, because engaging faithfully will mean taking on things you never thought you would take on. It will mean engaging people you never thought you would need to engage. It would mean experiencing things that would cause culture shock and break your heart because of things that you had not been exposed to. But I encourage you, bear with, because when I served in inner city education, what I learned from my young eighth grade boys was that they were only willing to share with people who they thought they could be safe with, who once they started laying out the trauma, we wouldn't get it up excited and concerned and start backing away. And we serve a God who is able to handle anything. and that we can endure all suffering because of Jesus and his finished work on the cross and the gift of the Holy Spirit who walks with us and comforts us through everything we might experience. We can handle engaging faithfully. So don't listen and then engage and then withdraw because it's too hard. You've got to stay to the plow. One of the things my wife and I had to agree upon, and you know in marriage and ministry, this is hard. We will not consider another call. We will not consider what is next. We will not consider anything else until we have established faithful, consistent presence here where we are planted. You have to listen because that's where you learn what God is doing. You have to engage because listening and not engaging is hypocritical. But you have to bear with because to listen and engage and withdraw is traumatizing to a community that has experienced that over and over and over again. We don't want to be that church that when the money ran out, they left. We don't want to be that church that when the neighborhood got difficult, when crime rates started to rise, when things got harder, we just walked away. I always think back to the words in the Old Testament prophets, seek the good of the city where you have been made exiles. While we are not citizens of this world, we are here to seek the good of the land around us. I can tell you that at Bridge City Church, this social experiment has not always been easy. But what I have learned pastorally is that when we learn to listen to one another, to share our lives together, take it beyond Sunday morning and take it into your week, into your public practice, into your job, into your careers, and then to bear with through suffering, through hard times, through difficulty, through discomfort and inconvenience, what I have learned is that that's how families are formed. In fact, if you can testify like Romans 5, perseverance, it produces character. And most of us have learned our hardest lessons through the most difficult seasons of our lives. And so, for us, practicing faithful presence means listening, engaging, and bearing with. And so Bridge City does not stand as a hallmark to say this is how you should do it, but we have a posture that says that we are always able to learn something. We have a posture that says keep staying at the plow. Keep celebrating with the community. Keep lamenting with the community. Stand there. Show up when things happen. Show up because the community is watching. Last story I'll share with you. We have two parking lots on our campus, smaller parking lots, and I personally park in the back of the church on the neighborhood street. And one of the reasons why I park in the back of the church on the neighborhood street is so that I can meet people and I can engage with people who I wouldn't be able to engage with when I'm in the parking lot. And so when I'm coming to my car, when I leave something in a car, when I'm packing up to leave, whatsoever. I also park there so that the community knows this is Pastor's car. Don't, you know, keep Pastor's car safe, praise the Lord. You know, I kind of yell a prayer as I'm walking into the, oh, Pastor's here, going into the church. Don't touch my car. But anyway, this opportunity to just be there in my car. About a month after we opened the church, we had been there for a year and a half, and I had started parking there in the back. I can remember on a Sunday morning, I could see that the family down the street was just really having a difficult morning. And it was some form of a conflict between neighbors. And as much as I was urgent and willing, wanting to get in the church, get in my office and begin praying and, you know, getting ready for the service and all those other things that pastors pretend to do before they preach, I felt like I needed to go see what was going on. So I walked down the street and immediately I recognized person who engages in our neighborhood network. And she looked at me. She immediately started crying. And I said, what's going on? And she said, I'm so glad you came. She's like, my son got in trouble last night. He went over to these people's house and things got diced up. And I said, okay, where's your son? She's like, I don't know where he is, but the family's here. They're yelling at me. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I said, okay, you go get in my car. Walked over to the other family and said, what's going on? So I'm the pastor down the street. You know, you gotta give some official titles, you know, make sure you're safe, you know, hey. I said, everything all right? Anything I can help with? He's like, well, I wanna find this boy and we need to figure out what's going on with this young man. And we need to figure out how I'm gonna, I don't know, I still to this day don't know exactly what happened. But I know mom needed a moment. She needed to get out of that situation. So I said, well, here's what we can do. Can I ask you to take my number down and give me a call this week, either later today if necessary? And I'm gonna get with mom and the son, and we're gonna figure out what we need to do to redeem all of this, but let's take a moment to cool off. And you could tell that although the man was angry, he had some religious respect for authority. And he says, okay, pastor, that's fine. Say, here's my card, make sure you communicate with me. Mom gets in the car and mom's like, I just don't know what to do. I can't keep doing this with my son, so on and so forth. I said, mom, I wanna meet your son, wanna figure out what's going on. So I'm gonna drop you off around the corner, let you go home, but please text me and I wanna, you know, get with your son. After service is over, I come out to my car. And there's four boys waiting by my car. Two of them, I can tell these boys are younger than adult. And two of them have a vape in their hand. And I'm like, what's going on, guys? And the young man, one of the young men with the vape, he said his name. And I said, hey, so gentlemen, what happened last night? And they told me that basically what happened was they got into an altercation with the kid, and the altercation turned violent, and they broke some property on the man's house. I said, okay, what do we need to do to fix this? You know, I'm used to be an administrator. I know how to talk 14-year-old. He's, you know, and so I said, hey, you guys, go ahead, go home. I'm gonna take Charles with me, and we're gonna figure this out. Take Charles to the neighbor's house. We talk it out. The guy who was angry did not know it was a kid who was 14 because he wasn't taking the time to listen to the mom who was hysterical. Found out the kid was a teenager. Guy owns a car parts shop down the street. And I said, what can we do to figure this out? I know you want to get your property back. What needs to happen? He goes, young man, do you like cars? Kid says, yeah, I like cars. When he said, yeah, I like cars, he said, why don't you come and work at my shop this weekend and we'll consider the debt paid. I said, all right, cool beans. I said, now we got to figure out what's going on with mom. So we went over to mom and mom says, hey, would you mind just kind of mentoring him from time to time? I said, take my number. Call me whenever. Doesn't matter. I want to be able to support you. This prayer turned into a woman who is a part of our church, loosely connected, who has received support from our church, who calls our church her home. The young man comes and every now and again works on cameras and serves in our church. In fact, it was funny because I didn't know the grandmother brought them to church one morning. I said, Charles, go get on the cameras. And she grabbed him like, don't you get up there. You don't know these people. And Charles said, that's my pastor. Their siblings go to a school that's on our campus now. The whole family is engaging with everything our ministry does simply because I saw an opportunity and I went and engaged. Now, I'm not telling you next time you see a fight on your street, walk down the street. I'm telling you, listen, engage, and bear with, and let God handle the rest.
So Keon and I are both deeply formed in a philosophy of ministry called Christian community development, and that principle of listening is deeply, deeply central to this. It connects so well with what we want to be doing here in the EPC in terms of being that presence in the neighborhood, serving and those relationships being developed to be able to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. An encouragement for you in your churches as you would go back to those churches, one of the great ways to help just start to rhetorically move into this posture is to pull away from using the language of we're going to bring Jesus to people. Because was Jesus ever kind of waiting for anybody to bring him anywhere? Do disciples bring Jesus? They follow Jesus, don't they? Jesus and his spirit are already present in your neighborhood and at work. So go follow him. We're going to go bear witness to the work of Jesus in this place and proclaim his good news so people can come to a saving faith in him. As we kind of wrap up this time here in a few minutes, an encouragement for you and some of the stories that we try to share. You've heard a lot of stories. I just want to share one more story. One of the things that our church did years back as a part of this intentional listening in our community in Beaver Falls was to say that we don't already know everything. We need to go pay attention. And so some of the neighborhood mapping that Pastor Keon was talking about, intentional listening, and then partnering with existing folks doing good work. Christian and not, and you need to be wise about those relationships. God can give you wisdom in that. But who's already doing good things in this place, redemptive things, things that neighbors would look at and say, this is good for this place. And then find ways to connect, support, and even partner, getting your people involved. We had a season of about 5 years, very intentionally, where we were just joining in the good things other people were doing while we were trying to find what's our unique part to play. What is Soma's unique part gonna be to play in this neighborhood? And so one of the things that we came up with early on through some of that experience of listening and a process was the development of a community garden space. And so this community garden, this little urban farming space, a number of different reasons why that makes sense. There's a bit of a proclamation already in there. When you're talking about gardening, you're talking about the gardener, you're talking about creation, you're talking about God, right? So great connections there. Also, it itself is a listening space, because as you're working with neighbors, it's not just our church's garden, it's the Beaver Falls Community Garden. Working with neighbors, there's a lot of opportunity for conversation. Conversation about life, and then ultimately conversation about the things of God. And so one of the things recently that happened, and there's a lot of great stories connected with that garden, I got permission from Joe and Morgan to share this story. Joe and Morgan moved into Beaver Falls during COVID time. And if you tried to move into a new place during COVID, how easy was it to go out and meet people? Not so easy. But our church was safely having opportunities to still be out in the garden, right? Great place to be, outdoors. Could be distanced in a helpful way. But they started to get connected and then started to get connected to some of the people through the work of that garden. Through that connection, got connected into the life of the church, because invitation is just a part of the culture of that church. You invite people, and it's not a high barrier for entry. It's intentionally set up for unchurched people. And so Joe and Morgan and their kids started coming, and they came for a while, and were listening, were involved with everything, hadn't come to a place of faith, but they still got to belong. And then in the course of relationship and conversation, Joe came to the place where he said to someone in the church, you know, I think this stuff makes sense now. I think I actually believe all of this stuff about Jesus. And this person got to have that conversation. Well, here's what we mean by that, and didn't use the three circles, but a similar kind of process. And Joe said yes to the lordship of Jesus Christ in his life. Not long after that, Morgan, his girlfriend, said yes to the lordship of Jesus Christ in her life. This year, the day before Easter, Joe and Morgan were married, and then on Easter Sunday, Joe, Morgan, and their daughter were baptized into the life of the community of faith, right? So this is that idea that it's that intentional listening presence. Where is God already at work? How can we then partner with what God is already doing? Developing relationships that the gospel of Jesus Christ and his kingdom might be demonstrated, proclaimed, people invited into the life of Christ, and then become a part of that good news community. And so I'm like that Gen X millennial in between thing. One of the Gen X characteristics is we're super cynical, and I have that. And so I don't like the story that ties up real neatly and is kind of cute and all that. And so, but I can't stop what happened. Literally, on my way to the airport, because the community garden is right across the street from my house, literally, as I'm driving to the airport, there's Joe and Morgan working in the garden, and they're working with a couple folks who are not a part of the church. And I know Joe and Morgan love to tell the story of how they came to know Jesus. And so I thought, oh, that's too cute, but it's true, so I want to share it with you. Like how it's meant to continue moving forward, but in a genuine, authentic way, when those relationships are established, that posture of listening, exegeting, where is God already at work here? And there is beauty in your neighborhood, friends. Ken and I both work in ministry and economically under-resourced communities and all that attends that. If we can say there is beauty here, you can say there is beauty in the place where you are. You'll also find brokenness. But the redemptive work of Christ in his kingdom, that beauty, that's what's brought to bear against the brokenness to demonstrate and then invite into the good news of redemption of all things in Jesus Christ. Amen. And so a couple resources to be helpful for you, along with the practices that Pastor Keon was suggesting, that intentional listening, that faithful presence, that neighborhood mapping, the bearing with, also practically resources such as a demographic tool. We actually have a relationship with an organization called Church Answers. It was started by Tom Rayner, who does a lot with church health across the denominations. And this is a resource. It's a demographic psychographic tool, which basically it gives you all of like the U.S. Census data. If you're familiar with like a Percept study or Ministry Insights or one similar to this, similar but really really helpful. We have a denominational partnership with them now, and so we have a discounted rate for this tool. So you set the parameters, the neighborhood around your church, and who is here, who lives here. What are the demographic breakdowns? What are even the religious proclivities and affiliations? So you get a sense. A lot of our churches, maybe we don't really know our neighborhood very well. This could be a helpful quantitative way to get an understanding as we lean into some of those practices like prayer walks and partnerships to get to know in a more relational way. We also have church health coordinators. You've heard about them. These are folks, I'm in this role, 15 of our 16 presbyteries have these. We'd love to work with your church, your congregation, to help resource what it looks like in that church health process to begin to reach out and get to know your neighborhood for faithful gospel witness. And so please, through your presbytery, connect with one of us in your presbytery. Also, at lunchtime, there is a lunch to meet your church health coordinator. If you want to meet your church health coordinator, you've got a lunch to meet your church health coordinator. Feel free to come out and do that. And then also, last one of those suggested resources is the equipping sessions tomorrow. That's right, yep. So a lot of equipping sessions tomorrow, particularly the church health ones, what to do in transition, which speaks to the same church health process. But then also, Stefan is gonna be leading on doing less better, a way to focus your ministry of your church so things don't get distracting and cluttered. And then also, Pastor Marc Farrell is going to be, along with preaching tonight, make sure you're here for that, leading a session on developing the evangelistic culture of your church. Okay, so you have been in this room for a while. We started with music. You've listened to a lot. Thank you for listening so patiently. I want to spend the last 5 minutes, if we can, praying. And here's what I'm hoping in our prayer time. If you can find someone close to you who does not go to your church, not someone already in your church, if you can find them, and then let's have about a 5-minute season of prayer here. Real briefly, introduce something about your community around your church, your neighboring community, your parish, your neighborhood. Name something beautiful, name something broken, and then spend a minute or two in prayer for each other's congregations in communities. That's something we can do for about 5 minutes together, and then I'll bring us back and we'll pray together. So let's spend a few minutes in prayer where we are.